happen at the same time.
Oh, you can.
The Midweek Morning Manna. It's so good to see everybody this morning. Hope y'all are doing well. We're excited about being here today. Take your hymnals. We're going to look at number 243. There's a sweet, sweet spirit. I love this old hymn. It's a wonderful old hymn. Let's just sing it from our heart. Spirit who loves us so very much and who wants to guide us and direct us and lead us in every area of our lives. Lord, today we're thankful for each and every one that's gathered here. We're grateful, Father, for their families, for their homes, for their lives, what they mean to our church, to our community. Thank you for their faithfulness through the years. Lord, I just continue to ask that you'd bless our ministry here at First Baptist Church. Lord, just use us to reach others for you. I pray, Lord, for Mr. Danny today. I lift him up to you. I ask that you be with him. Pray for so many others, for Miss Linda as she continues to do her treatment. I pray for her. Lift her up to you. I pray for so many others who have lost loved ones, those families that have families in the nursing homes and those in the hospitals. Lord, we just lift them up to you. What a joy it is to be here, Lord. I continue to pray for Dexter and ask that you be with him as he ministers and gets ministered to. Lord, I pray for so many today that are waiting for you to touch their lives and just be a special God in their lives. I pray, Lord, that you'd help heal the hurts, help be with us in our times of trial and difficulty. And so today, Lord, lead us like a wonderful shepherd. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. All right, let's sing that next one, number 61. Savior like a shepherd, lead us. What a wonderful old song that I love to read and sing, okay?
Savior like a shepherd, lead us. Much we need thy tender care. In thy pleasant pastures, lead us. For our use thy fold prepare. has brought us thine. We are thine to thou befriend us, be thy guardian on our way. Keep thy flock from sin, defend us, seek us when we go astray. Blessed Jesus, blessed Jesus, hear, oh, hear us when we pray. Blessed Jesus, hear, oh, hear us when we pray. Early let us seek thy favor, early let us do thy will.
I sure do. I was fixing to say that. Vicki played that at my wedding. We had that song at my wedding. I sure did when Lan and I got married. That was my first wife 40 years ago. That's right. All right, 153. We're going to sing my tribute. I love this old song. Remember Glenn Lewis singing this when they came for revival a long, long time ago.
A million angels could not express my gratitude. All that I am or ever hope to be, I owe it all to thee. To God be the glory. To God be the glory.
God has done some neat things. I mentioned to pray for Danny. Miss Frieda's not here today. Danny had to have a heart cath this morning, and he's doing fine. There was no blockages, so the Lord answered that prayer. And Miss Linda, Miss Carol asked about Miss Linda Earls, and I just got a text back from her. I asked her how she was doing. She said she got back from a treatment. She says she's doing really well. And Tony said the other day when I visited with him, he said she's done really, really well. So y'all keep praying for them and asking the Lord to continue to be with them. We miss them. It's been a while since we've been able to see all of them. And so you keep praying and just ask the Lord to be with us. All right, number 644. Count your blessings. Here we go, sing it out.
When upon life's billows you are tempted, tossed, when you are discouraged, thinking all is lost, count your many blessings, name them one by one, and it will surprise you what the Lord hath done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God hath done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God hath done. Are you ever loaded with the burden of care? Does the cross seem heavy? Are called to bear. Count your many blessings, every doubt will fly, and you will be singing as the days go by. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God hath done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God hath done. So amid the conflict, whether great or small, do not be discouraged, God is over all. Count your many blessings, angels will attend, help and comfort give you till your journey's end. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God hath done.
Man, that's good. I like that. Y'all did good on that. Praise Him, praise Him. Number 227. Wonderful old hymn.
Praise Him, praise Him. Jesus, our blessed Redeemer.
Praise.
unto the Lord belong. Praise him, praise him, tell of his excellent greatness. Praise him, praise him, ever in joyful song.
You guys have done a great job. Let's finish off with 637. Come ye thankful people, come. What a wonderful old hymn to get us in the Thanksgiving spirit.
Come, ye thankful people, come. Raise the song of harvest home. All is safely gathered in ere the winter storms begin. God, our Maker, doth provide for our wants to be supplied. Come to God's own temple, come, raise the song of harvest home. We ourselves are God's own field, fruit unto
everybody. Good job. I know a lot of y'all was looking at that one. You didn't know about that one, did you? I seen that. All right, Peter, you ready? Come on, buddy. Let's sing. Have Mr. Pete come and play us one on the harmonica. Let's give him a big hand. I sure appreciate Mr. Pete coming, being a part of our midweek morning manna. It's always a joy to get to see him and his red suspenders. I like those red suspenders.
Now, y'all know. Don't be surprised if I goof on this, because I just learned how to play it, I guess, last week. I was sitting around there by myself, and I thought I ought to learn a different song, so here we go. It's an old song, goes way back 1900. Tell me the story of Jesus.
Thank you.
Wednesday, Thursday, through the rest of the week, all the way off, so that'll be really good. So don't miss that, and we want to make sure that everybody gets to be a part of that. Also, Sunday, tomorrow night's Cowboy Church. It's Cowboy Church. We'd love for you to come if you get a chance. We're going to have a good time there and enjoy that time together tomorrow night. I'm looking forward to it. And then on Sunday morning is our life groups and worship, and at 10, and then at 4 o'clock on Sunday afternoon, we'll be having a Thanksgiving meal here in the Family Life Center. We'll have a time of worship at 4, and then when we finish with our worship time and some testimonies and sharing, we're going to have our Thanksgiving meal with our church family. That'd be really the first thing we've done since COVID as far as a big meal, besides the what we did with the Wild Game Supper. So would love for your family to come, love to have a big crowd, love for people to show up and be a part of that. So I hope that you'll be here. We're looking forward to a great, great time. And so then it'll be time. Don't forget your poinsettias. If you haven't got a poinsettia yet, you may sign up back there. We're going to order them, and Cole and I will get them next week. And start ordering those and have them here. And then when we get done with them the last Sunday before Christmas, you can take those home and enjoy them or give them to somebody. But they're in honor and in memory of folks, and so we appreciate that. So it's going to be a good Christmas season. We're looking forward to it. We're going to have a pastor's staff Christmas banquet early in the month. We're also going to be doing our community Christmas that we always do. And so we'll be sharing in those things. We'll be coming to your life group, sharing with you about helping to get some Christmas presents for our children. And so it's going to be good. So I look forward to being a part of that. So take your Bibles and turn to Psalm 78. We have almost finished, and we're hoping to finish today. And with Psalm 78, man, we're accomplishing some stuff, aren't we? Now, we may be in Romans for the next 6 years, but we're going to get this done, all right? We are to verse number 56, Psalm 78. Remember, I told you this is a maskil psalm. It's a teaching psalm. We're learning from the history of the nation of Israel. We're learning from God's people. And when we talk about God's people, and I've told you time and again what God did, and then what the children of Israel did, and then what God come back to do, and how that God has just kind of been a cycle of good, of highs, and of really, really lows. And if you'll remember, when the children of Israel had rebelled in the desert, and part of this is a story of their rebellion, but God just decided one day he was going to wipe all the children of Israel out, just going to do away with them. He was going to annihilate them all. And Moses went before God. He begged on their behalf, and he said, "Please, God, don't do that. The world needs to know that you're God, you're their God, and you love them and you take care of them." And so God, the Bible said, God relented. God came back and he didn't destroy them. But you know, guys, when we sin, and all of us do, when we sin, we know that there's repercussions of that sin. We know that there's, God forgives that sin, but we know that there's things that we have, there's consequences to those sins. And so we know that the Lord is in control and he's taking care of us. So in Scripture, when you read about Egypt, it's basically one of the types of the world. You remember we talked about the other day, James says, do not love the world nor the things of the world. He said the love of the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, those three things. You don't love the world. If the love of the world is in you, then the love of the Father can't be in you. So, but it's a type of Egypt. Egypt is a type of the world today, if you will. And what happened was when they decided that they wanted to go back, you know, they whined and complained about how all the good food they had in Egypt, and they didn't have nothing but angel food to eat. And then God shipped them all a bunch of quail, and they had meat and they had bread, if you will, the food of God that angels eat. And so they continued to cry and whine and complain. They continued to test or tempt God over and over. And they remembered not the hand. You know, you've heard that old phrase, don't bite the hand that feeds you. That's what they did. They bit the hand that fed them. And so same thing for us today. Let's learn from this. Let's learn and let's go back and remember. You see, they tempted God. They believed the lies of the devil and they provoked the Lord. So let's read chapter 78, verse 56. All right, you got it? Say, I got it. He said, yet they tested or tempted and provoked the Most High God and did not keep his testimonies. Now, again, they decided, well, why are we out here in the wilderness? Lord, we could have done better back there being a slave. And God had freed them. You see, God, sometimes we get in such a mess, we don't even realize how bound that we are. We get in such a predicament that it becomes comfortable. You've heard me talk about time and again that bucket of sin. And that bucket of sin that's out there before us, we'll go by and we'll look at that bucket of sin. And Satan's always trying to tempt and test us. And we look at that bucket of sin and we walk by it and begin to think about it. And we begin to continue to think about it. Then we go on about our business. Then we come back that afternoon going back home and we think about it some more. And we think, well, that ain't nobody around. Nobody gonna mind. It tastes good. And it feels good, and that bucket of sin is just what, and the children of Israel continued to delve in that bucket of sin. They continued to get there, and they would get out of that bucket of sin, but they'd go back to that bucket of sin. Sometimes that's kind of like us. The next morning you get up, and you sit a stick, and you put a little finger in it, you get your hand in it, and it really feels good, and it smells good, and you put that other hand in there, and then it's time to get on to go to work, and you come back that afternoon, and you get those elbows in there, and then you all of a sudden stick a foot in there, and that feels really good, and then trying to get out, and it's time to go home, so you pull it back out, and you think about it all night long, and you come back, and then you get in it, and then you're in it, neck deep, and you can't get out of it, because you've gotten in that bucket of sin. And that bucket of sin plays for keeps. That bucket of sin don't want to let you out. And you finally cry out to God. And God comes to our rescue and pulls us out. But there's consequences to that bucket of sin. And the children of Israel missed so many opportunities. And when they were serving the Lord, when they were in that wilderness, remember, every one of them from 40 years and an age above had to die. They couldn't go into the land of promise. Every one of them. So that was part of their consequences of sin. And we find they continued to test God in the wilderness. They continued to test God. You know, they were afraid when they got to the very edge of the promised land. When there was, Pharaoh was in the back and looking in the front was the Red Sea. They didn't know what they was going to do. You've led us here to die in the wilderness, you know. And God's a way maker. God made the plan. He took care of that. They get into the land of promise. They had to go to battle. They had to go to war. The people are not going to lay down and give up everything. And God told them, here's what I want you to do. He laid it out, and when they didn't do it, it always came back to bite them every time. We're studying the book of Joshua, and on Wednesday night in my men's life group, and as we're studying the book of Joshua, we're learning that when they don't do what God says to do, when they don't consult God, when God says to consult him, when they don't ask God for wisdom, when they don't ask the Lord to direct their path, something always comes up, and the land of promise has become a total minefield and a total shipwreck, if you will, and finally God brings them back around. But again, the consequences of those things. We're going to talk about Caleb tonight. Caleb was 85 years old. 85 years old. And he cried out and he said, that's my mountain. He said, give me that mountain. I want that mountain. He said, I'm just as strong today as I was 45 years ago. That's my mountain. I'm going to get it. And the Anakims were living there. That's the big, tall, giant people. That's where the Philistines lived. And we find that they went in and he conquered that. But it was a promise of God. God promised him that. So remember, it's never going to be easy. Never. It's never going to be easy. When we lay down in this old world for the very last time, when our life is over, then we know the best is yet to come, all right? The very best is yet. God's got something better than this old world. Aren't you glad? I mean, think about how good God's done for us and what he's done. But see, God, if you will, is not going to share you with anybody. And that's what the children of Israel wanted to do. They wanted to share. What did we want to share? We want to share with idols. We want to share with false worship of false gods. They wanted to share with the things that are false religions. And so God said, no, I'm not sharing you with anybody. So they tested, verse 56, and tempted or provoked the Most High God and did not keep his testimony. They didn't keep the word of God. Verse 57. They turned back and acted unfaithfully like their fathers did and they were turned aside like a deceitful bow. They continued to want to go backwards. They continued. You know, Jesus said in the New Testament, no man, having putting his hand to the plow, can look back and draw and plow a straight row. You can't do it. You're going to get off. You're going to do this. You can't learn. You can't take your eyes on your vehicle off the road, because if you do, you take it off the road, you're going to veer one way or the other. You got to be careful. You got to know what you're doing. You got to pay attention. And the children of Israel provoked God. They tempted God. They tested God. And every time, God's love, His mercy, His grace, that big old barrel of grace I talked about Sunday, that big barrel of grace, God's grace was even sufficient way back when, His goodness and His mercy. So let's look again when He says in verse 58, for they provoked Him to anger with their high places. They was worshiping other gods. They was worshiping other gods. God's not sharing you. God's not going to share you with anybody. So quit trying to let the world sway you in such a manner. God doesn't want to share you. He loves you. Didn't one of the Ten Commandments say God's a jealous God? Thou shalt have no other gods before me. God said that first one, okay? So He said they provoked Him to anger with their jealousy, with their high places, and moved Him to jealousy with their carved images, the idols that they brought into the world. And remember, when God would tell them, go in, conquer this land, annihilate everything. Don't take anything for yourself. It's all God's. It's all mine. Or go in and wipe out men, women, and children. Well, why? Because if they didn't, they would come back to bite them later on in their lives. So years, that's why the children of Israel is still in a battle. It's still today they're still in a battle with Palestine. There's always a tension there so very much. So He tells us this. God heard, verse 59. Here's the persistence of God. They decided they was going to keep following these false gods. And God said, when God heard this, He was furious. He was furious at them. He said, and greatly abhorred Israel. He despised His own people. Think about that. I mean, think about how ugly it had to get when God said, we're not doing it. I'm not sharing you with anybody. But they continued to persist. They continued to do. If you will, it's a very terrifying act, or a very terrifying figure of speech that God's using here in His Word when He says He abhorred Israel. He was sick to the bone to them. He despised everything that they did. And remember, this is His children. This is His people. This is His chosen ones, okay? You know, when you get upset with your kids, you know how that hurts, and that hurts you. And if you carry that around, it stays with you. It don't go away. Can you imagine how God must have felt? He's got 2 million folks out there in the middle of the desert that depend on Him every moment of every day, and they don't know that they're depending on Him. They think that they can do it themselves. We can't. John 15:5 says, without me, you can do nothing. Nothing. So, the scripture is true. So, the people persisted to follow false gods. The enemy's triumph would beat them time and again. And so, verse 60, so He forsook them. He said that He forsook the tabernacle of Shiloh. Now, Shiloh was where the Ark of the Covenant had been placed for a long time. And because of the rebellion of the children of Israel, God removed that tabernacle, or God removed the tabernacle, and He removed the Ark of the Covenant from Shiloh and moved it to a new place, to a high place, if you will, to Jerusalem. And so the Bible says, the tent He made among the men and delivered His strength into captivity. They went into captivity. They were Babylon had come to get them. He said, and His glory into the enemy's hand. The enemy overtook. The enemy actually had captured the Ark of the Covenant. And that was the Ark of the Covenant was the actual very presence of God. And so God was there. And if you'll remember, if you'll go back and read these stories about them, it'll tell you about how that they put the Ark of the Covenant in the same room that one of their gods was at. In the morning when their God, when they would come back in there to where they would come in to worship, their God would be laying on the floor. Our God was stronger than their God. And they wonder, what happened? Well, God's not sharing you with anybody, okay? He's not sharing his throne for anybody or anyone. So as you do these things, as we realize this, he delivered his strength. God said, you can have it. This is what you've asked for, so you can have it. Guys, that's one of my concerns for American church today, for Western churches today. God's going to give us what we ask him for. Notice, we want to have religion without relationship. We want to have fun and not have fellowship. We want to have do our own thing. No, we don't want discipline. We don't want God to discipline, and that means so there's no discipleship. We want to do it our own way. We want to row our own boat, raise our own sail. We're going to get what we ask for if we're not careful. We've got to stay on the firing line, so to speak. We've got to stay where he wants us. He said he delivered, verse 61, his strength into the captivity and his glory into the enemy's hand. God gave them up, and they got what they asked for. 62, he also gave his people over to the sword. Battle. There was a constant battle in there with this, and he was furious with his inheritance. They was, God, why didn't you do this for us? Well, the reason they didn't is because they forsook God. Reason they did, God didn't bless them as he told them he was going. It's a land flowing with milk and honey. You got to go in and take care of it. Well, it's a little hard. You see, guys, what I found is that when things get hard, people quit. When things get hard, people quit. You guys know that. You're the generation that's worked through hard times. You're the generation of people that knows what it is to do a hard day's labor. You know that. We can't get people to go to work today. I talk to our farmers all the time. They can't get nobody to go to work. Can't work for them. Don't want to work. They can make more money sitting at home. It doesn't make sense to me. We've got when Lana and I was in California, from California all the way back to Arkansas, help wanted signs everywhere, and nobody was wanting to work. Nobody. It's amazing to me. We want it easy. I don't read anywhere in this black book where it's going to be easy. Not anywhere. It's going to be tough, and there's going to be battles to fight and battles to face. And again, God gave the people over with the sword. He was furious with his inheritance. Verse 63, the fire consumed their young men, and their maidens were not given in marriage. They begin to live sensually. They begin to have relationships, but didn't have in the sacred bond of marriage. They begin to do their own thing, and their maidens were not given. The Bible says their priests fell by the sword, and their widows made no lamentation. You see, we find even way back in the book of 1 Samuel, he speaks about how that Eli's sons, Eli was the priest, if you'll remember, and Eli's sons were wicked men. They were having sexual relations in the temple with the women who would come to worship, and they would belittle them and steal and abhor the things of God. And Eli was a blind old man who had gotten soft in his old age, didn't do anything about it, but God did. God took care of that. He took care of those boys just like that. And that's when we have young Samuel on the page, when young Samuel comes in to be the judge over Israel. And the Bible says, verse 65, he said, then the Lord awoke from his sleep. Now, listen to that. Do you hear that? This is a God who never sleeps or slumbers. Now here's what I mean. Here's what we're going to mean by this. He said, like a mighty man who shouts because of wine. It's like somebody waking up from a drunken stupor and they just go nuts. Well, what's happened to God? God's decided, here's what we're going to do. This is the point. He let them do as they pleased, and then he said, that's enough. Okay? That's enough. We're not going to have that anymore. And so God began to take care of those things. God began to do those things as he woke up, as one would wake up from a drunken stupor. He said, and he beat back his enemies, and he put them in perpetual reproach. The children of Israel now had done the improbable, but yet God had done the impossible. When he would rub them back and bring them back. I'm reminded of the story of the prodigal son. The story of the prodigal son is one of my favorite, because all of us are prodigals. We've all been sons and daughters, and we've all tucked tailed and decided we could do it better, hadn't we? We've all done that. But yet, in our mess, God gives a message, okay? Through our messes, God brings us a message. And that message is come home. And so the boy decided, hey, I can go back home. And so when he went back home, his dad ran to meet him. His dad came to meet him, put a ring on his hand, put new shoes on his feet, bought him a new robe. He had a big party for him. He said, because this my son was dead and now he's alive. Folks, aren't you glad you believe in the resurrection, that God can raise up the dead? That's our God. You see, the Lord awoke from his sleep. And he beat back his enemies and he put them in perpetual reproach. You see, we find when Israel had to come to that place in their life, what God did for Israel because of what they did to God. They did things to God that they shouldn't have done. We do things to God that we shouldn't do. And yet God, with his arms open wide, he loves us, brings us home. I love this. Then he says in verse 67, he says, moreover, now that's always a good word to highlight in your Bible, because God got something. He says, I got something else to tell you. Moreover, remember this is a teaching psalm. Moreover, he rejected the tent of Joseph. Now, Joseph was the guy that had the dreams. Joseph was the guy that went to Egypt. Joseph, the guy that went from the pit to the palace, back to the pit, into the jail, and then he was second in command over Egypt. He was the big dog, and he found out that God had rejected him from being the leader. Why? Because he wasn't in the right step with the Lord. He said they did not choose the tribe of Ephraim. Ephraim sinned. The tribe of Ephraim sinned. Remember, you can't get away from those consequences. Those consequences are there. But he chose the tribe of Judah. Who did the Jesus come from? The Lion of the tribe of Judah. That's who Jesus came from. He says, he chose the tribe of Judah, Mount Zion, which is Jerusalem, for his place, which he loved, and he built his sanctuary like the heights, like the earth, which is established forever. He also chose David, his servant. Now, circle that word servant. God could have said, king, my King David. He didn't say king. God could have said, the finest warrior that ever was. He didn't say he was a great warrior. He said, he's my servant. What does that tell us we ought to be doing? Serving. Exactly. Because, the Bible said that David was a man after God's own heart. David loved the Lord, and even in his midst of messes that he made the messes. God gave a message out of his messes, just like us. And the Bible said he chose David, his servant. What a high honor that God gave him and took from the sheepfold. He said, if you will, he brought him. You remember where they found David? Where was David at when the prophet went to his dad's house to look for him? He was in the pasture, in the back pasture. All the sons came through and he said, no, not any of these guys. Have you got another kid? Yeah, one more. David, he's a ruddy kid. He's out on the backside of the pasture over here. He's tending my sheep. Send for him. And when he came, the man of God, Nathan the prophet, said, there he is. He's the man. And God chose him, and God blessed him, and God used him. So he took him from the sheepfold. The sheepfold, he brought him in to the family, and he used him. He called him a servant. He said, from following the ewes that had young, he brought him to shepherd Jacob, Israel. That's the nation of Israel. His people and Israel as his inheritance. God blessed him in a tremendous way. And then I love this last verse. He said, so he shepherded them. God shepherded. He brought them back home. He shepherded them according to the integrity of his heart. God brought them home, and he said, come home. It's time to come home. And he brought them in, and he put them in. It's like Jesus. Remember, Jesus told the story about the good shepherd, how that the good shepherd leaves the 99, and what does he do? Goes and picks up that one lost sheep. That one sheep, and he picks him up, he puts him around his neck, and all back he go, as they go back to where the rest of the 99 are at, I'm telling you, he's talking to him, he's fussing at him a little bit, he's scolding him a little bit, but all the while he's rubbing his nose, telling him he loves him, and folks, that's how our God does. He shepherded them according to the integrity of God's own heart. He said, and guided them by the skillfulness of his hands. You see, our God does that. Our God guides us. He leads us. He helps us. When I don't know what to do, guess what? I'm going to talk to the Lord. Lord, I don't know what to do. He's okay. Let's talk about this, and let's visit about this, and let's get serious about this. And he prompts my heart, and he puts on my heart, it's time to pray, Kim. It's time to get serious about prayer. It's time to seek my face. It's time to do what I've asked you to do. And what have we talked about of being having revival in our land again? 2 Chronicles 7:14. If my people who are called by my name shall humble themselves, seek my face, turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven. Then I will bring them home. Folks, God's in the business. He's like this. He's just like this, saying, come on, come on. You know, it's kind of like today is Darcy's one-year birthday. She's 1 year old today. Oh, we was with them last night, and she's just walking around like she owned the place, you know, and just having such a good time. And today's her one-year birthday. And you know, and pretty soon, now that she was crawling, and we just, boy, she would get where she wanted. Now she's walking. Pretty soon, she'll be running. You know, that's kind of like how our kids are. And we put them around our, and how much do we love our kids? We love them, don't we? We care. Even when they don't do what we ask to do, same thing we've been reading about in Psalm 78. The children of Israel did this to God. They turned their back on him. They walked away from him. They didn't want nothing to do with him. And yet God, in his infinite wisdom, come home. Come home. I love you. Come home. Come home. It's all, I'm here. He says he's a never leaving, never forsaking God. I'll never leave you. I'll never yet forsake you. God forsook his own son on the cross of Calvary, but he'd never forsake you. He'd never walk away from you. He loves you that much. Jesus came to pay our penalty. Jesus came. So we're going to learn from this psalm. This is a teaching psalm. This is a psalm that helps us learn from the past. History has spoken. Folks, I don't get what we're doing in the United States right now when they tear down all of the monuments and things such as that because it offends somebody. Folks, understand, it's always going to offend somebody. That's the problem. But the thing about it is you can't rewrite history. History is history. And folks, understand, you can't rewrite this book regardless if you like it or you don't like it. Regardless if you enjoy it or you don't enjoy it. That bucket of sin is real. You know it as well as I do. You get your finger in it, and guess what? Before you know it, you're engulfed in it. And there's consequences to pay for it. God wants us to trust him. Learn from the past. Learn from the past. Let's pray. All right? Father, thank you today for your love for us. Thank you for your mercy and your grace. Thank you for teaching us and how that history teaches us how that you're such a divine tracker. You're just like an old hound dog on a bone. Lord, you track us and you love us and you care for us. Lord, so today, I'm so thankful for your word. I ask you, Lord, to be with us, to guide us, to lead us. Lord, we're here just because we want to know more about you. We love you very, very much. We're thankful for your goodness and your graciousness in our lives. We just ask for everyone who hears under the sound of my voice tonight through social media, for those maybe without a relationship to Jesus, that they would learn from what God has done. He loves you. He's proven that. He's never going to leave you. He's never going to forsake you, regardless of what we do. The Bible says there's nothing that can separate us from the love of God. So, Lord, tonight, help us as we follow after you. I thank you for these precious folks that have gathered here this morning. I thank you for the folks that are watching tonight. I pray for them. I pray that we would learn, and we would learn the great lessons from you, God. We need you, and we thank you in Jesus' name. Let's sing, I Surrender All to Jesus.
All to Jesus I surrender. All to him I freely give. I will ever love and trust him in his presence daily live. I surrender all.
all God's people said, amen. Thank you guys so much for being here today. What a great group of folks. Thank y'all for coming. Thank you, Miss Vicki. Thank you, Mr. Pete. Sure appreciate y'all. Thank you for singing with me. We're grateful. Again, next Tuesday, 11 o'clock, bring something good to eat. I like all kinds of food, you know, except coconut pie and things like that. I'm out on that. But chocolate pie is my favorite. But anyway, we'd love for you to come back. Love to be here next week. Don't forget this weekend, worship time. And we just pray that God would bless in a special way. Thank you so much. Have I forgot anything? No manna next week. Yeah, we won't be meeting Wednesday. We're meeting Tuesday, okay? We're meeting on Tuesday, all right? All right, well, let's pray. Father, thank you today for everything you do. Thank you for these precious folks. Give us a good week. Continue to help us to reach out to those in need, to those around us, bless our community. Help us, Lord, to be a help to those who need a special touch from you. God, guide, direct, and lead us. Bless those in the hospitals, in our nursing home, those recovering. Today, bless them in a special way. Thank you for all that you do. In Jesus' name, amen. Thanks, everybody. James got lunch for us. Thank you.